WYFF News 4, live local breaking news at 6.
Good evening, I'm Michael Cogdell.
And I'm Carol Goldsmith. Police say a bank robber made a big scene near the heart of Spartanburg, and they tell us a GPS tracking device placed inside the money bag helped lead to his arrest.
News 4's Mike McCormick is live and local on the story. He's at the Spartanburg County Jail tonight. Mike, was he armed?
No, he was not, Michael and Carol. Police tell us he did not have a weapon, but they say he actually did wear a disguise, which included gloves and sunglasses.
This is what it looked and sounded like on the east side of Spartanburg just after a robbery at the First Citizens Bank on East Main Street Monday morning. Police say the thief's disguise included a surgical mask and a hoodie.
We know that for a brief period of time that he was running. He was running away, and then he got into the car that was parked somewhere else.
Officers, deputies, and troopers eventually got behind the getaway car.
He was following all the laws, you know, using his turn signal left, right, of course, and he wasn't speeding or anything.
Hello Kitty. Police say they cornered the car, which had the cartoon cat on the license plate and seat covers. The eye-catching end to the ordeal got a lot of attention as law enforcement swarmed the scene near the park in historic Converse Heights.
He put his hands out the windows when the officer made the approach.
After spending a few minutes in the back of a police car, officers took him in for questioning. An officer later took him to the detention center. Police say his name is Reginald Lyles, and he's been charged with bank robbery.
What a great thing about it is, you know, just help from witnesses and just the officers being close on the scene. And enough officers that we had was able to bring him to stop and get him arrested.
And because of what happened, Houston Elementary, which is near the bank, was put on lockdown for about 30 minutes today. Mike McCormick, WYFF News 4, live tonight in Spartanburg County.
Mike, thanks for that. It was too much alcohol that killed a Presbyterian College football player. 21-year-old Kyle Allen died Sunday. A student found him unconscious at an on-campus residence around 5:30 Sunday morning. He was soon pronounced dead at the Lawrence County Hospital. The coroner released an autopsy report today. It says Allen stopped breathing as a result of alcohol intoxication. The coroner would not reveal the exact blood alcohol level, but says the student's death was accidental. According to the Presbyterian College website, Kyle Allen was a linebacker for the PC football team.
We are learning more about why a teenager was shot in the chest over the weekend. Deputies say it's complicated and still unclear if any laws were broken. News 4's Angela Rodriguez is on the story for us tonight. Angela, what happened?
Well, the victim knew the shooter well enough to drop by unannounced, but investigators say it appears the man was startled and thought he was in some kind of danger and then fired.
Greenville County deputies say an unexpected visitor was shot Saturday night as he tried to say hello. It happened after dark in a backyard along Tanner Road. Deputies say the shooter was approached from behind.
The victim made some sort of gesture to grab to get the acquaintance's attention, and this acquaintance got spooked and shot this victim. So right now we're trying to determine whether or not there are any criminal charges to actually be filed in this case.
Investigators say a 19-year-old was shot in the chest, and after the shooting, the teen reportedly drove off and called 911 from his car. The teen parked at a nearby grocery store, and just before 7:30 p.m., an ambulance took him to the hospital.
Witness interview in this instance will be key. You know, determine exactly what happened, when it happened, and how it happened will be key in this investigation.
Investigators say there were several witnesses, but to protect the integrity of the case, they're not releasing any names or the address of the incident. It's still not clear if any laws were broken.
We're trying to determine that. What would cause someone to be spooked enough or to be that jittery rather to not pay that much attention to and end up firing a shot at someone. Again, you know, we're not sitting here saying that this rises to a criminal element right now, but the circumstances surrounded are vague enough to where we've got to do an investigation and got to ask those questions.
And at last check, deputies say the teen is still in the hospital and stable. Michael?
Angela, thank you. Now to Cherokee County, where deputies passed out flyers today hoping to crack a 10-year-old case of murder. Someone shot Pastor Perry Posey to death in 2002. It happened here along a frontage road near I-85. His car was covered in holes from a shotgun. A few days later, investigators found the murder weapon about 6 miles away, but they've yet to make an arrest here after 10 years. Posey was the minister of Shady Grove Baptist Church. If you know anything about his death, you're asked to call the Cherokee County Sheriff's Office right away. Malden police have released a sketch of a suspicious man who was seen around Bethel Elementary School. Take a look at the image. Police say this man was seen Friday parked in front of the school looking through a pair of binoculars. A school crossing guard noticed him, approached the vehicle, and police say the man then drove away. But he was later spotted, just a few minutes later, in fact, parked in the school drop-off loop. Police say he was trying to talk to a student. When a teacher interrupted, the man sped off. Police say he's possibly 20 to 30 years old with a medium build, and he was driving a gold Honda Prelude with custom rims and a large spoiler. If you have any information about this man, call the Malden Police. There's the number, 864-289-8900.
A trip to the gas pump is once again painful. In fact, gas prices in South Carolina are more than 40 cents higher than they were at this time last year. News 4's Gabrielle Komorowski tells us why.
It didn't take long to find someone groaning over the price of gas.
I think they should leave them the same. I'll bring them down some. Hey, we need to save money around here, you know?
Drivers have been spending more money lately to pay for a fill-up. According to AAA, the average price of a gallon of regular gas in South Carolina is currently $3.36. 1 month ago, it was $3.21. 1 year ago, it was $2.94.
And according to AAA, the highest price in the upstate last year was reached on May 12th, when people were paying an average of $3.76 a gallon. What people are paying today isn't all that far from that number.
Linda Birch of AAA in Greenville says you can blame the higher prices on the unrest in the Middle East and refineries cutting back on production.
Refineries have cut back a little bit on their production, and when that happens, it kind of slows down as far as availability out on the market, which can increase the price of gas.
Drivers may be paying more, but these numbers have many considering driving less.
Pretty much keeps you to the home front, you know? I don't know what you can do.
Gabrielle Komorowski, WYFF News 4.
And remember, prices tend to go up when the temperature goes up as more people hit the road for vacations. Don't wait until the last minute. That's what a group of elected officials wants to tell people who are not registered to vote. As News 4's Sean Mazzarello explains, they're specifically reaching out to minorities and the poor.
November is still a ways away, but the process of registering to vote can be taken care of long before then. That's why this caucus of elected officials has started a new campaign called My Voice, My Vote.
It's a very simple process.
They want people to understand that voters are purged from the voter registration list if they have not participated in the last two election cycles, which is every 4 years. A letter sent out in an attempt to verify the voters still living at the address before the name is taken off, though.
But they need to be reminded to be a part of the process. So it's just a matter of our going through voter education as well as voter registration.
The group also used the podium to express their opposition to the South Carolina voter ID law. Governor Haley signed it into law last year. The U.S. Department of Justice struck it down. Haley has vowed to challenge the federal ruling, saying it will cut down on voter fraud. Critics, though, say it restricts the voting rights of minorities and the poor.
Getting on a plane and doing other things that where we must show ID, those things are privileges. They're not rights. We have a right to vote by the Constitution.
For them, it's all about removing the stumbling blocks they perceive will keep people from the polls in the fall. Sean Mazzarello, WYFF News 4, Greenville.
Now, anyone who wants to be reinstated on the voter registration list should contact their county voter registration office.
We've all heard the saying, but if you ask one upstate man whether good fences do, in fact, make good neighbors, the answer would be no. New at 6 tonight, News 4's Keisha Foster on why a newly built fence has a Greenville County homeowner furious.
Obviously, it's atrocious. The fence is, it's way too high. It blocks the light coming into our sunroom.
Homeowner Dustin Earnhardt no longer likes the view from his backyard on Britton Way in Greenville County.
It's just really a shame that they would put something like that up that could affect someone else's life.
Earnhardt is talking about the 15-foot fence a neighbor recently put up.
It's awful. The view from inside our house is completely blocked. We have no ambiance inside this sunroom that we have on the back of the house. It's pretty much useless now. An entire portion of our house now we can't use.
Earnhardt and his wife moved to this home nearly a year ago. He says after living there for several months, they became frustrated with the neighbor's dogs continuously barking at night.
And so myself, in conjunction with several of our other neighbors, called animal control.
In August and in January, Earnhardt says he and some other neighbors sent letters of complaint to the Greenville County Animal Control.
I believe the fence was put up out of spite. We have previously had some problems with the neighbors with regards to their dogs.
And there is nothing the opposing homeowners can do. That's because there is no homeowners association for that neighborhood, and there is no county ordinance that deals with the height limit on fences.
I don't know what the impact is of this fence is in terms of a financial recourse in terms of what my property value is going to, what's going to happen to that.
Keisha Foster, WYFF News 4, Greenville County.
We did try to get a comment from the homeowners who put up the fence. They were not at home. Earnhardt says there is a small chance the fence is on his property. He plans to get a surveyor to come out. If that is in fact the case, the fence will, of course, have to be taken down.
A decision from the White House is raising the ire of some upstate Catholics. The Department of Health and Human Services is requiring church-affiliated employers like hospitals and colleges to provide insurance coverage for birth control.
I think that's an affront on our religious liberties. It's kind of a shock. Of course, we knew it would be coming.
Tonight at 11, what Catholics and their leaders are calling for to reverse this decision.
So does yesterday kind of seem like a season away?
It does,
to you?
Doesn't it?
Really? Man,
what season is it today, John?
What a change.
We're back to winter again.
Yeah.
Yesterday it was a spring. Today is winter. It's just ridiculous, that roller coaster ride that we continue on. Tomorrow, we're going to be a little bit milder tomorrow afternoon. Mm-hmm. But yesterday, low 70s. Today, 40s.
40s.
Yeah, upper 40s.
At least you can laugh about it, John.
25 degrees.
That's right. At least we have that going for us.
At least we got that going for us. Exactly. Live Super Doppler 4HD showing a few showers in the Midlands to the coast with that coastal storm. But as that coastal storm continues to make its way offshore and continuing to move away from the East Coast United States, it's taken the clouds with it. And we're already starting to see the breakup of the clouds throughout our entire area. And that's going to continue that trend as we go through this evening. The last chance will be right along the Tennessee, North Carolina border. Your clouds with the northwesterly flow will kind of hang in there for quite a while. They'll probably won't clear out until late tonight. But with the downsloping winds now in the upstate and northeastern Georgia, the Piedmont of North Carolina, we will continue to break up the clouds and see clearing skies tonight. 46 right now in Greenville, pretty chilly temperatures, mid-40s in Greensboro, also in Raleigh, upper 40s in Florence, and in Augusta, this pocket of clouds and very chilly temperatures for us. 55, though, a little more sun the farther west we go. 55 in Atlanta now, 51 in Macon, 57 in Hilton Head. That was earlier this afternoon, I should say, with the sunshine warmed us up out to the west, and that's actually going to move across our area as we go through tomorrow afternoon. So 41 only in Boone, mid-40s in Charlotte. It's only 44 right now in Spartanburg, 46 in Greenville, Anderson, also in Greenwood, mid-40s in Athens, upper 40s in Columbia. They had a couple sprinkles from time to time. Southeastern part of the upstate, even you folks in Newberry County, had a couple of raindrops at best. For the most part, we were just cloudy and chilly today. Humidity levels remaining fairly high. So with somewhat drier air coming in, we could even see a few patches of fog develop later on tonight, especially along some of the rivers and creeks. Light and variable wind across the entire area. So, well, I'd like to have shown the almanac that we had yesterday when we were in the low 70s. Instead, upper 40s. That's the best we can do. And we started off only in the low to middle 40s this morning. 37 this morning in Nashville. Notice at the airport there, 51 degrees this afternoon, actually warmer. I talk about it a lot. That cold air is pretty shallow. It backs up against the mountains. And then as the warm air goes up and over the mountains, it's actually warmer in the mountains on this type of a day with an east to northeasterly wind than in the upstate itself. Nationally, looks like this. Coastal storm, most of the energy is offshore, continuing to move away from the United States. 32 right now in Denver, 42 in Minneapolis. Still, most of the country still above average for this time of the year. There's the coastal storm moving away. High pressure building in tomorrow. We may start off with a few clouds. We may see a few high, thin, cirrus clouds from time to time, but plenty of sunshine, and we're going to warm up nicely. A milder afternoon tomorrow. 31 for the overnight low in the mountains, 37 degrees in the upstate with clearing skies across the area. Tomorrow, high 53 in the mountains with mostly sunny skies, plenty of sunshine, some high, thin, cirrus clouds from time to time. So a chilly start to the day, but then again, with sunshine, we're going to warm up nicely into the low 60s tomorrow, and maybe even a little bit warmer on Wednesday with a few more clouds around, especially in the morning. Then a lot of clouds. Series of cold fronts come in on Thursday, Friday, into the weekend, gradually cooling us down. In fact, the upcoming weekend could be pretty chilly. In fact, it could be one of the coldest weekends we've had in quite a while. Huh. Right now, it looks dry but chilly.